Good afternoon. Welcome to another press conference dedicated to repressions against healthcare professionals. Please feel free to write your questions into the chat box, or you can ask to have the floor, and we'll let you enable your microphone and camera, and you'll be able to ask a question live. The English interpretation is simultaneous, it's available. If you want it, the icon is where it used to be, where it usually is, the globe icon down below. You'll be able to get this interpretation. Right. All the media representatives, all the journalists, please rename yourselves to match the following format. Last name and in brackets your media. Media outlet or agency that you represent. In that case, we'll be able to relay your questions more properly. Well, introducing you properly and also citing the media agency or outlet that you work for. Our speakers of the day are Andrey Tkachov, is the coordinator of the Medical Solidarity Foundation. Hello. And we have Yulia Matusevich here, former lecturer at the Belarusian State Medical University, also a nurse. Yulia, good afternoon. Hey. Okay, so as usual, during the press conferences, we'll give the speakers the opportunity to make an introductory statement. Andrey, could you start by talking about the situation in the domain of healthcare, about the fund that you represent? Right, so I'm the coordinator of the aforementioned Belarusian Medical Solidarity Foundation that helps the repressed medical doctors that are unfortunately being repressed against the same way as other people are facing this, other people face this prosecution. The activity of the foundation implies or involves both financial support and legal support. Legal services to doctors that got imprisoned. According to our data, probably there's more people, but they just do not apply for help. According to the data that we have on hand, 20 people are serving short-term prison sentences. And there are 15 plus medical workers, healthcare professionals that have been fired because of their political views since the elections. But obviously there's more of them because this dozen and a half are only those who applied to us, applied for help. So that's it in a nutshell.
Okay, спасибо.
Right, thank you. Yulia? Okay, I know that you prepared something to tell us. Yes, indeed. I used to work for the Belarusian State Medical University. I was, I'm the external part-time worker. I used to work at the laboratory for practical training. And together with other tutors, teachers, we first shot a video appeal from the BSMU colleagues to support our students, because starting August, some students have been awarded or have been imprisoned for the short-term imprisonment, administrative arrest, and some received fines. But it so happened that because of my work, I had to be present at one of the rectorate sessions to where the list of students who voiced that were expelled because of their political position. I voiced my attitude, my take on this. I said this is this is intolerable, this should not be tolerated, and I was fired because of that. I'm in touch with the students that I used to teach. I was also in touch with the students that were on the brink of being expelled. Right now I know that two students, two girls refused to be reinstated. They do not want to change their political position, their civil position, in exchange for the studies. So they want to continue their medical education, but they refuse to give in and to succumb to those ploys that the management of the university throws at them. I also know of two other students who are on the brink of being expelled, because on the brink, by that I mean nobody saw actual documents that they have been expelled. Two of them went to Poland. So both of them went to Poland. One of them already applied for a Kostus Kalinowski stipend to become a student in one of the Polish universities. I also know that several students are still studying at the medical university, but they're looking at ways to get education abroad. Because even those students that reported back for studies, they do not really feel the opportunity, or they do not really feel safe, because they might be kicked out after the winter exams. They do not feel themselves protected.
Так, ну, напоминаю всем нашим
участникам. Okay, thank you. Just a reminder to all the participants that your questions can be messaged into the chat box. Feel free to type them in.
Вопросы уже пришли.
We have had some of the questions by now, so let me just voice them or relay them as I have them here. Andrey, this one might be for you.
И вопрос к деятельности Белорусского фонда медицины.
The question about the activity of the Medical Solidarity Foundation. Tatiana Gargalu from Deutsche Welle is asking what kind of assistance the repressed doctors can hope to get. Well, the repressed doctors can first and foremost count on payments. We cooperate with the Bisol Foundation that does these one-time payments of 1,500 euros to healthcare professionals that were fired because of their civil stance. Additionally, we will facilitate employment so that these repressed healthcare professionals got employed elsewhere, because healthcare professionals is a sort of a narrow area, so it's difficult to employ them, well, just like that. In other cases, we have attempts of them. They wanted to become employed with private medical centers, but the administration rejects them or refuses them, and they're forced to leave the country. Additionally, the foundation also renders legal support to those medics that apply for it. We render assistance to the families of the medical workers that found themselves in a challenging situation because they were arrested. They are subjected to administrative arrests. They serve as short-term detentions, short-term imprisonment, 10 to 15 days normally. We also compensate the days that the people were out of work, well, they couldn't work. We pay them as if they were working according to their profession.
Также вопрос от Татьяны Горгалык. Я думаю, что...
There's another question from Татьяна Горгалык. I believe it goes to both speakers this time, the second one. What is the actual situation with COVID in Belarus? What is the real situation? So, Andrey, let's start with you, because you've been cooperating with BiCOVID Foundation, BiCOVID-19 Foundation.
Работникам во время начала...
was tasked to help the medical healthcare medical workers at the outset of the pandemic. Maybe you can share some inside information. What is the actual situation for COVID in Belarus? Yes, indeed. Back in spring, I was one of the coordinators or the volunteers of BiCOVID-19 initiative that helped medical workers struggle the COVID pandemic. According to our situation, according to our information, the situation is much worse than it used to be in spring. Even seeing the official data, official stats that the Ministry of Healthcare publishes that are still very remote from reality, even seeing these figures, we can say that the epidemic in Belarus has crossed the spring threshold. According to the unofficial stats that we are receiving from healthcare professionals from various institutions countrywide, the official stats is 5x to 10x lower. I mean, they suppress the figures. Thank you, Yulia. Do you have anything to elaborate? Yes, indeed. The thing is, the official stats is definitely downplayed. I fully support the previous statement. Andrey said that it's 5x to 10x lower than the actual figures. I would also like to highlight the fact that chiefs of medical institutions report that there's enough protective gear, but in practice, it's not the case. Medical workers experience a shortage of these protective means. The second wave of coronavirus is more severe because more people require artificial ventilation, lung support. Protective gear, right. I just used the Russian abbreviation, but the interpreter is proficient with this too. Right, so thank you.
Так. Также есть вопросы, вот...
Okay, there are further questions. Belarusian service of the Polish radio.
Что также был вот ультиматум от
медицины. So we've heard that there was an ultimatum from the healthcare workers, and it's a question from the Polish radio. The question is about this ultimatum.
Достаточно солидарно изъявляется медицинская.
Is the medical community solid enough? Is there enough solidarity to serve Lukashenko with an ultimatum that if he does not resign until a certain time frame, until a certain deadline, all the healthcare workers will start a national strike without any deadline. The journalists could have been replaced by Russian ones. I don't think it's the case with HCPs and nurses. Okay, Yulia, you may want to start. Okay, agreed. The thing is, according to the legislation of Belarus, the medical workers cannot go on strike. The road repair guys or plant factory guys, they cannot go on strike. They are supposed to render emergency services at all times. The ultimatum that was issued, it is about this. So the medical healthcare workers will resign. They will, or they will continue working according to protocols with masks, with protective gear available, with full support of the work, with logistical support of the work that they have. Clearly, according to some polls, about 30% of HCPs are prepared to resign within 30 days. Not all of them are prepared to leave the medical profession completely, because some of them have fears that they are not experienced enough to find employment elsewhere. So most people don't have a second background because, like you said, the medical field is quite narrow. I mean, a medical doctor cannot completely change the domain. They cannot become barbers or hairdressers or something. But anyway, so for the moves that I see right now, around 30% are prepared to turn in the resignation within 30 days. Part of the doctors is willing to support the so-called Italian strike. Some part of the HCPs will continue working as usual, as they used to, but there is also another category of doctors. They cannot leave their employment because they're indeed highly skilled. They're top experts in that area. If they cease rendering their assistance, their patients will be in trouble, will be in a lot of trouble, and they might suffer because of that doctor's decision. So the doctors are reluctant to resign. Yes, I would like to elaborate. The medical solidarity is strong enough. We've had cases when there were attempts to fire people through political reasons, healthcare professionals. And the entire staff stood up for their colleagues. They brought their resignations as well to the head doctor. As a result, the medical workers were not fired, the ones that were initially intended to be fired. According to the medical ultimatum, this was widely broadly discussed in the medical community. There were many opinions voiced about it. The questions here are both economic and ethical. So there are two domains of problems. According to medical ethics, medical workers cannot reject rendering medical service to people in need. I'm talking primarily about the ICU workers and the emergency teams, ER. Nobody is really saying that these guys are going to resign, these people are going to resign. Most likely, they will put forward some stringent requirements to their administrations, to their management, as to compliance with the labor code, including mandatory availability of protective gear, protective equipment, and compliance with all the points of labor law. Employment, working hours, everything must be complied with, according to everything must be in line with the legislation. There is a number of requirements. We have an open letter of medical workers that has been signed by almost 5,000 people by now. Among the main points there is cessation of violence on the part of the law enforcement and security forces, investigation into every instance of violence and punishing the guilty ones, the perpetrators, and the free and honest elections. Many DSCs, many academicians, many prominent figures in medicine have left their signatures under this letter. So it is safe to say that the medical community is indeed a serious force. It is, I wouldn't say that it's a serious threat, but it does have leverage on the things happening in the country. But saying that all the medics, all the HCPs will get resigned en masse, that's a bit premature to say that. Although, like Yulia said, according to various polls, up to 30% of healthcare professionals are prepared to just up and leave.
Спасибо.
Right, thank you.
Пауль Флюкигер, Neue Zürcher Zeitung, это швейцарская...
Neue Zürcher Zeitung, it's a Swiss newspaper from Paul Flückiger.
Медработников.
Is there generally enough doctors in Belarus, or you have a problem with work immigration to Russia, to the EU, like Poland is facing? Yes, we have seen statements of our, how do I refer to this guy mildly, from Alexander Grigorievich, who stated that he's not really preventing the medical workers from leaving, may let them go to Poland but not come back, but let them stay there. This is what he said. At the same time, we also get a lot of information that there is a shortage of medical workers, there is a shortage of them, including because of the COVID pandemic. Unfortunately, healthcare professionals also tend to get sick. They are no longer able, during their sick leave, they're unable to help people. So yes, according to our information, there is a shortage of staff. There is a shortage of staff indeed. Just recently, I've read up on the facts, doctors on average work on 1.34 full-time equivalents. So they're doing more than 100% of what they're supposed to. Doctors, nurses are even, nurses have it even worse, 1.5 FTEs per person. So basically, there was a matter of labor migration. People went to Russia because we don't have the issue of having Belarusian diplomas recognized there in Russia. We don't have language problems, Russian speakers in both countries. There are certain issues with labor migration to the European Union, because in that case, the diploma needs to be validated and certified. Also, language proficiency is a must. At least for German-speaking countries, that's B1 for healthcare professionals, B1 language competence level. I'm also aware that if doctors really want to, they pick up German or English and Polish in 1 year, and they master it to professional B1 level, B1 competency. They pass the test and they go abroad. It used to be the case previously, it used to be like this before. The figures for migration are probably different than compared to 3 months before the elections. But if the situation runs as it is running right now, if the situation unravels like it does now, HCPs will want to leave. I just like to elaborate that Poland is preparing law amendments, legal amendments, to employ Belarusian medics following a simplified procedure. As far as I'm aware, Lithuania is also preparing this sort of
amendments.
Right. A follow-up question about Belarusian healthcare workers abroad. Albert Verzhbitsky, Belarusian service of Polish radio, is asking whether there are medical workers that had to go abroad because of political reprisals? And if so, what kind of help does the foundation render to them abroad? Yes, indeed, there have been several medical workers that had to leave the country by Seoul, paid them, made these payments as forced relocants. People that were fired because of political, because of their political views, these people are worked with. There are negotiations to employ them in the countries that they found themselves in after they left Belarus. Okay, and a clarification from the Hong Kong journalists from Kaoru. Is it possible for medical professionals to operate in Russia without extra qualification license, without diploma validation? Yes, indeed, that's what I... Yes, that's what Yulia confirmed. Yes, it is possible for them to do that. It's a union state. Plus, there is a nuance, unless the doctors are criminally prosecuted, like, you know, these trumped up charges that are used against them. And in that case, doctors had to leave to a non-extradition treaty country. Okay, the questions are still coming in. Deutschland Funk, Inga Isenkevich, say 30% of doctors resign. What does it mean for patients? We know that narrow experts are fired and the contracts are not renewed. How is that a threat to the patients? Well, it's a challenging question per se, because partly elective operations
которая началась вторая волна в
республике. Suspended. Planned operations are suspended because of the second COVID wave. Emergency services are rendered as before. Narrow experts, well,
насколько я знаю и слышу от
врачей. The thing is, as far as I know, as far as I've been hearing from the doctors, nobody wants to turn down patients. Especially narrow field experts, they're prepared to do it on a volunteer basis. They're prepared to help people. But not within the framework of their work, of their civil servants or civil career, the state-owned medical institution career, that's meant. So they are prepared to go through trouble. At the same time, the doctors are prepared to render consultancy services, advisory services to patients, but not to work for the benefit of the system. Largely. Okay, I just want to elaborate on this. Particularly us, but not just us, we're developing a program to help patients using telemedicine services. So if medical workers are fired, they'll be able to continue their medical practice privately, including remote services, telemedicine. Their services can be exported to other countries even. This way through telemedicine.
Да, спасибо.
Зигрид Шпиндельбек is
Nadran, Austria.
Austrian Nadran organization.
Взломан телеграм канал.
As we know, the белые халаты, the white webcoats channel was hacked. Is there a new channel, белые халаты, that is working? Yes, I can take that question because I actually saw the hacking happen. I was at my workplace, so I was there in the channel. According to our information, one of the administrators of the channel was physically arrested. They came for him. And the partial access to the Telegram channel was gained using his devices without his willingness, of course. And that channel started posting various stuff. They changed the avatar to the coat of arms, the Belarusian official coat of arms. At the same time, there was another channel created that beat the subscription figures of the original white lab coats channel. We encouraged the users of the hacked channel unsubscribe and subscribe to the new one. Let me check out the stats. I think it's 40+ K subscribers at this point. Wow. Let me just open it. Yes, 41,000 subscribers for the new newly created channel. It's completely safe. All the administrators are outside of Belarus. For this reason, this cause will continue to live on.
Вопрос от Марека Бикермана.
Question from Marek Beckerman, Media Tower.
Можно ли охарактеризовать и классифицировать?
Would you describe and classify the approach of the authorities to the health professionals as criminal, and by extension, the policy of the coronavirus as a violation of human rights, denial of the right to health care? Yes, indeed. Healthcare workers are repressed against during the pandemic time, during the COVID time. Narrow questions, narrow experts are repressed against that could have, if not repressed against, they could have done many surgeries and saved many lives. So this is the way the genocide is happening against the Belarusian people. At the same time, distorting the figures, the government of the Republic of Belarus, they're lowering the figures again. They're giving false recommendations, and that is another occasion to say that this is genocide against the Belarusian population. Yulia, yes, there is also a violation of healthcare professionals' rights, because when they fall sick with COVID, I have people actually know, doctors and nurses, they are not granted sick leaves, they are not sent for PCR, although there are obvious signs. And people still show up for work, they continue working, they ask questions, why are you not granting my sick leave, because I can actually infect people, they come to appointments. Well, they get this, well, you understand the situation. You understand the situation. This is what the management says them. Well, it's kind of like a motto. Well, you understand the situation, kind of a motto of the modern day Belarus.
So
what is the actual reason? Why are they not granted sick leaves? Why are they not tested? Well, most likely this is done to reduce the statistics, to show off or to sugarcoat the statistics, say that COVID is not a problem for healthcare workers, they don't fall sick, there's low mortality, and everything is fine with COVID.
Yes,
so they're covering up the prevalence of COVID among healthcare workers. People fall sick because they're not granted protective equipment the way they're supposed to get it. So this is why, this is how the bulk of the disease is happening.
Созданием своего образа своеобразного такого мемориала.
Now there is a so-called memorial, in a way, a memorial to healthcare workers dead from COVID, dead because of COVID, is being created. This is not open access data so far, but we're collecting this data, and we hope to get this in place soon.
Во время исполнения своего
healthcare professionals that died in the line of work because of COVID contracted by patients or contracted from patients.
Максим Дмитриев, я так понимаю, что вопрос касается.
Okay, Максим Дмитриев, I believe
COVID-19.
His question is about the COVID-19 pandemic. Is it possible to initiate the collection of actual real data, including for past periods? So that those captured the power would not be able to seize that process. So bottom line, is it possible to collect honest statistics, even retrospectively, for the pandemic?
Well,
that's an interesting one. As far as we know, and it's basically a fact, in late spring, early summer, the EPAM company developed software and passed it to Ministry of Healthcare free of charge to collect and analyze the morbidity of COVID-19 and tracing the contacts of first and second tier. So all the data in that system was transparent. However, as we know, that system was never launched by the official Ministry of Healthcare.
Ее положили на полочку и забыли, в том числе.
It was swept under the rug and forgotten about, because if it had been implemented, the actual statistics would have been available to too many people.
Сейчас мы получаем статистику непосредственно.
Now we're receiving the statistics directly from medical institutions, including for the number of identified COVID cases and lethal outcomes.
Сбор и анализ.
Yes, indeed, the collection and analysis of this data is in progress, and I believe that shortly we will use our webpage and the Telegram white lab codes. We will publish the statistics there.
Yulia, хотите что-то добавить?
Okay, Yulia, any elaborations on that? No, fully second what Andrey has said. Lorenzo Di Stasi, freelance journalist,
has
asked the question, are there cases of violence against doctors at work in hospitals by the police?
Случаи насилия при задержании, безусловно, были.
There have been cases of violence when people, when healthcare workers were detained. Andrey Vitushka's case is well known. On the 10th of August, he ended up in the detention center. He was beaten up together with his son. He was thrown into prison. Yes, indeed. Working. Healthcare professionals are repressed against same as rank-and-file members. But right now we see fewer cases of them being arrested and getting more loyal treatment than other people. Because the law enforcement believes if they beat up a healthcare professional today, if they need medical help tomorrow, another HCP might simply reject it.
Okay.
All right.
Вопрос Юлия.
Question to Yulia.
Вы работаете, насколько я понимаю, с ассоциацией.
You're working with the Genome Association, as I understand.
Can
you please tell us about the special impacts on children with disabilities?
Спинальная мышечная атрофия.
Yes, SMA, spinal muscular atrophy. I work with Genome. I work with people with ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. And as far as I'm aware, the situation that's unraveling in Belarus right now, it has not affected the standard of care and the quality of care to either people with SMA or ALS, including children. So the help that is possible to render in Belarus, it is rendered as usual, nothing changed. And some children have been able to collect money to raise enough funds to get Spinraza and be treated abroad. They are treated there. So, no, the actual situation has not had a special impact on the children with disabilities.
Спасибо.
Okay, thank you.
Ну, хочу спросить у наших журналистов, уважаемых.
I'd like to ask journalists here, do they have any questions? Because it looks like all the questions that I received have already been asked. Any request to take the floor?
Уважаемые журналисты, если вы хотите задать...
Dear journalists, if you want to ask a question to the speakers, now would be the time.
Сейчас.
Please do so now.
Я могу пока рассказать про фандрайз, который...
Well, I can spend this time to talk about the fundraising.
Вчера был запущен на Фейсбуке фандрайз.
Yesterday, the fundraising campaign was launched on Facebook by the Belarusian Medical Solidarity Foundation.
Именно для того, чтобы...
The fundraiser was initiated to expand the BISOL mandate, because BISOL is only paying or making contributions to people that were fired. Healthcare professionals need more than that, not just cases of them being fired. There are many cases of fines. Healthcare professionals are not imprisoned, but they are fined nonetheless. And we have the possibility to help them pay these fines, including
компенсации экономических потерь медикам.
We will compensate losses of healthcare workers when they are deprived of bonuses. One of the ways to oppress against the healthcare professionals is to deprive them of their earned bonuses. So the Medical Solidarity Fund will cover these expenses, plus covering the expenses related to treatment. We know that the conditions of stay in temporary detention facilities are akin to torture in Belarus. And people that leave the walls of these institutions, so-called, they require rehabilitation. So the fund will handle that as well.
Так, мы получаем вопрос.
Okay, we're getting questions from the journalists.
Стази.
Lorenzo De Stazzi is asking a question. How many doctors are imprisoned right now?
Are
you somehow in contact with them? Well, right now it's impossible to stay in touch with them simply because of the fact that they are imprisoned. We work with their families, we work with their close ones. We help them with food. There's a separate website dedicated to helping families of HCPs and HCPs themselves. Right now, let me pull up the stats for the people serving sentence, short-term sentence right now. 21 persons are imprisoned. 21 persons are in this temporary detention facilities.
Очень прям серьезные специалисты, онкологи, урологи с мировым именем, которые делают...
Oncologists, urologists, top experts with worldwide reputation that perform important operations.
Да.
Да,
so, 21 persons. That's right.
Были задержаны, ждут судов.
That's right. And not just those detained and waiting courts.
Как это, административные?
Some people were fined, right? So there's 21 people actually in prison. There are many fines against medical workers. In most cases, they are fined, not imprisoned.
Okay. Следующий вопрос.
Right. Next question is,
подвергались ли Байсоль,
did Байсол and by COVID-19 come under suppression from the government, such as freeze of assets? Or similar solidarity organizations from the medical field. Yes, indeed, BISOL. Their website got blocked quite long ago from the territory of Belarus. It's only possible to access it using VPN. However, it did not impact the operation of the foundation. The contributions are made in full amounts. They are indeed safe, they are untraceable, and they are unblockable. There's no way the government can block that help. The accounts are not in Belarus. Help is not rendered from Belarus, from within Belarus. So it's virtually impossible to kill it. Follow-up question. Do you have tools to counteract the investigative committee's actions? Yes, indeed. Like I said, the money is not going... is not going to the bank accounts.
Так, есть ли смысл делать для функционирования здравоохранения?
If there is a point in creating alternative structures for healthcare functioning, where they're supposed to be based, in Poland or Lithuania? Well, alternative entities, that's a bit of an overstatement, but some functions of the Ministry of Healthcare are already performed by the Medical Solidarity Foundation. And I believe that our foundation's mandate will be expanded. We'll also buy protective gear, protective equipment, and supply to Belarus from abroad. So yes, indeed, we are empowering healthcare professionals, the so-called, I would put this a trade union in a way. We're kind of like a trade union for them. For any reprisals, any oppression, any attempts against medical workers, they can come to the Belarusian Medical Solidarity Foundation. They will get help.
Okay. Следующий вопрос. Как дела?
The next question is, what about COVID in prisons, detention centers, and so on?
серьезная эпидемия ковида, и практически все...
Yes, I believe that the situation is quite severe. People serving sentences in prisons, they come out of prisons testing positive for COVID, including healthcare workers. So quite recently, Dr. Marcello was released from prison.
And
they submitted tests, they passed tests, they were COVID plus, plus all the inmates were with COVID symptoms. But prisons do not render sufficient medical help. Medical workers are not allowed to help the inmates, and that's one of the forms of torture.
Alex Apple Daily, Hong Kong.
Alex Apple Daily, Hong Kong.
How bad
is the actual situation of lack of protective gear provided to hospitals during the pandemic?
По нашей информации, крупные больницы и...
Well, according to our information, major hospitals and infectious wards, infectious departments that are repurposed to help COVID patients, they are provided with protective gear. 100% or not, I'm not prepared to say, it depends on the any specific institution, but unfortunately COVID is happening across the board. COVID patients are also helped at hospitals that were not repurposed to help COVID patients. In that case, yes, the protective gear is not supplied sufficiently. That, yes, we know there are instances of shortage of protective means. Yes, I would just like to say that in major centers, major clinics are more or less doing more or less well. They also have a better situation with artificial lung support and oxygen. Oxygenators. But as far as tier one and tier two hospitals, they're doing worse. Regional hospitals, provincial hospitals, this not enough. Protective equipment, artificial ventilation is not non-invasive ventilation is not available the way it should be. Doctors say that non-invasive lung ventilation could be as efficient as with other viral pneumonias. But in some regions, there is a shortage of these non-invasive means to ventilate. There is also data from the fields that there is a lack of medical pharmaceuticals. Yes, so we see that the government has not worked on the mistakes they've made. In the previous wave, they have not prepared oxygen concentrators, protective gear was not purchased, a number of oxygen support points was not envisaged. So I believe all the money was spent on law enforcement. Okay, thank you.
Volkhoy Samashko.
It's probably going to be tomorrow.
Kaoru, you're live, yes.
Olga Semashko, Radio Ratsia.
Okay, we have Olga Semashko from Radio Ratsia. Two questions. Is there a general collection of data on the injuries sustained by protesters and detainees, difficulty and similarities, severity and similarities? Yes, it's one of the forms of protest of medical workers. They collect the data on injuries sustained by the protesters, and they submit it. Well, they submit it into a database. I will not disclose which.
Okay, Yulia, что-то хотите добавить или нет?
Нет, я полностью согласна.
Anything from your side? No, I fully agree with Andrey.
И другое питание.
And the second question from Olga. If the work on COVID becomes more challenging, will volunteers and businesses be allowed to help public hospitals? Well, I believe that in this situation, the government is not really keen to cooperate with the civil society, part of which is volunteers and businesses. So I don't really think that the government will look forward to volunteers and businesses coming to hospitals. Well, right now I know that undergrads and graduates of medical universities, they are transferred to work
пациентами на дому
at polyclinics to work with outpatient departments to ease the burden for the district doctors. I also know of a document a couple of days back. Paramedics and assistants of doctors will be able to issue prescriptions and basically prescribe RX drugs. This goes to say that there's too much load on the healthcare workers and the staff is too short, the staff count is too short to cover all the issues that the healthcare is supposed to be dealing with.
Я попрошу нашего переводчика
okay. который... Question to Yuri. A question from English. Right, here it goes.
Спасибо большое. Так, Алекс... Помогает ли ассоциация...
Alex is asking, is there any help from the association helping the doctors resign?
Квалификации за пределами страны.
Getting a new qualification outside of the country.
Уволившимся врачам с получением новой квалификации за пределами страны.
Ну, сейчас количество таких случаев...
Well, the number of these cases of people going abroad is not too big. We're talking about isolated cases. We are working with these people, eager to leave. And in this case, it's, well, in this situation, it's all case dependent, depending on the country in question, where the HCP left for. Ukraine, Russia, virtually no issues there. I mean, it's quite easy to both find employment and retraining if necessary. And we're also in negotiations with various institutions that could potentially invite the repressed healthcare workers to themselves, to their premises, to retrain them, to enhance their qualifications. So yes, there is a work in progress on that.
Спасибо. Так, ну, такой опять я запрашиваю вопросы от журналистов, пожалуйста.
Okay. Another round of questions from the journalists. If you feel like asking your question. Now would be the time.
Я сейчас посмотрю еще список вопросов, которые я получил.
I will check out the list of questions that I received before the press conference. I may have missed something from those sent beforehand.
Ну, мы немножко поговорили, да, про ультиматум.
Well, we've talked about the doctor's ultimatum, how it is expected to work in practice.
Что будет работать, вот.
So how is the doctor's ultimatum expected to work in practice? Yes, we've talked about that. There's a number of measures envisaged. Resignation is just one of the points, one of the options. Other options involve requirements for 100% compliance with the labor code legislation and the solidarity of doctors. If reprisals are made against specific individuals, specific HCPs, and they will face the threat of being forced out, one of the points in the ultimatum says that the rest of the team, medical team, will also be in solidarity with that, and they will file collective resignation statements. May I elaborate? Sure. According to the law and legislation, law on healthcare legislation, Belarusian healthcare workers do not have the right to turn down to render emergency help. But if it's elected operations or elected planned help, they can pick patients. And in this case, in solidarity with other medical workers, the medical community will simply use this opportunity. Because they can select patients to render planned assistance, to not emergency. I just contemplated the question myself. So could you tell me this? We know that the law enforcement people, they are treated, well, the bulk of them, they are treated at the Ministry of the Interior hospital. Yes, all of them.
Если у вас какие-то контакты?
Do you have any contacts with the people that work and treat them?
Возможно.
Possibly.
Я понял, спасибо.
Okay, I got it. Message received.
Окей. Ну, вопросов больше нет.
Okay, there don't seem to be many more questions.
Опять-таки, если кто-то из журналистов хочет задать вопрос.
If any of the journalists feels like to ask a question, now would be the time. So thank you, Andrey. Thank you, Yulia, for being here. Thank you for being part of our press conference.
Вот.
It's been interesting.
Вопрос пришел.
There's a last minute question coming in. The hospital for the Ministry of the Interior, it treats both the employees and their family members. That's right.
Хорошо.
Okay, thank you.
Один.
Well, there's another possibility.
Существует ли возможность?
There's another question. Is there a possibility to get in contact with some doctors? That's the, as far as I can make. Yes, Lorenzo, please feel free to come to our foundation. We have tons of contacts with many experts. Depending on the topic you wish to cover, or depending on the questions you have to ask, we can give you contacts, no problem.
Хорошо.
All right.
Скажите, как лучше обратиться к вам?
What is the best way to reach you for Lorenzo? Well, we have a Facebook page, Medical Solidarity Foundation. We can just post a link here to the chat.
Можете скинуть ее в чат, и
you can, you can type it, or you can copy paste it to the chat, and I will then email it when I to the participants when I'm sending the recordings.
Вопрос.
Okay, there's another question.
Поступают заявления, что сотрудники.
Occasionally there are reports that Ministry of the Interior staff members received injuries or sustained injuries. Is there proof of such injuries?
Есть официальные данные от МВД, по-моему.
There is official data from the Ministry of the Interior, I believe, that three people were injured. Well, maybe more. This Grodno alone, the city of Grodno alone, three people were injured.
Есть большее количество зарегистрированных.
But even if there are more injuries, we're talking about headcount not even close to the number of victims. That have been and are still coming in from the law enforcement. So many people got injured at police departments, at detention facilities. So we're talking that law enforcement injuries are hundreds of times and much less severe injuries than the protesters. On the other hand, the Ministry of the Interior, it's what they signed up for. It's what they do in the line of work. They get injured sometimes. It's not the peaceful citizens they take to the streets for non-violent protests. The law enforcement, the police, they are prepared that in their line of work, in their main line of work, they might be getting injuries. And they get injured, probably they're not competent enough.
Okay. Где можно найти вот
another question. Where can I find the database of injuries sustained on the streets? The one consolidated by volunteers. Well, like I said, this is a closed database so far at this point because of the security of people or safety of people that were injured. Because most of them are still in the country. However, all this data is being collated and it is being passed to international institutions, to the competent institutions. This database will be made transparent and the criminal case is launched against Belarusian law enforcement by this international institution that I'm not mentioning. We will see the database open. Okay, our time is running out. Thank you very much again, Andrey, Yulia. Thank you for asking the questions to all the attendees. Thank you to everyone tuning in and asking questions. We will send out the recordings as usual. So thank you very much for agreeing to be part of this today. Thank you.